scared. Welcome to the Lecture on Political Economy and Development in India. This lecture is the part of the paper on development communication. In this module, we will learn the agile development in India. We will understand the various guidelines and policies that were executed by the Indian state in tackling problems of education, employment, and funding, as well as macroeconomic indicators like economic growth. Introduction. The former guidelines say that political economy refers to the distribution of political and economic power in a given society and how that influences the direction of development and policies that bear on them. Political economy is directly linked to the directions of development policies. But what are these development policies? The field of development is vast and growing field, and over the last decade has taken on more and more importance. Over the years, it has come to mean very different things at different times and places. It can invoke very different meanings when used by persons or groups as opposite political stances. In newly independent India, the economy was in sync. The use and change of money at the center of the table and mainly in the state meant that the neoliberal project of the first two decades of independence was affected in a number of ways in the structure of the government. One of the great issues facing the nation was how to enlarge the possibilities of human development for the poorest of its people without exacting careless costs in human life, but unleashing the unpredictable social chaos of a violent upheaval. It was believed that democratic projects would allow for this drastic change in the social and economic structure of the country, and that this would help to avoid the apparently dramatic losses that took on a dark side revolutionary force from. The solution according to Nehru was to be set in using the vote to build a mass consciousness, in holding elections to overcome mass inertia, and in introducing institutional changes at the village level to spread organization of the most disadvantaged group in class-based political association. The Indian masses would exert sufficient pressure on the ruling class so that they would be forced to move towards a more democratic distribution of wealth. During the early years, there was a split within the Congress regarding the course that needed to be adopted in terms of the economic and social goals of the country. This is split represented by Nehru on the one hand and Gandhi on the other. Nevertheless, it stated that the capitalist economy and economic system that relied on the existence of private property that had been imposed upon India by the British had been disastrous. Those sides were firmly against a capitalist model of growth, as they recognized that it would inevitably lead to an even sharper inequality between the people of the country. To remove inequalities in society and that capitalism might have put in place the equivocal instinct. There was there were a major disagreement on the future plans to be taken. On the one hand, the Gandhis were firmly against industrialization as a means to the Gandhis, inspired by Gandhi's own belief that the two parts were able to retain its golden glory and determine to its deliver and force certain modern technology in the future. We believe that public investment in and control of modern industries could allow the nation to grow economically and equally. The final consensus between the two would directly result in the development strategy in terms during the new year. The consensus was represented with Gandhi accepting that industry could exist side by side with village handicraft so long as it did not supersede. The socialist accommodating and decentralization of all economic activity as far as the possible reduction of planning of the economy and the preservation of the village and the primary leader of the government. The belief in a united Indian socialism included a belief in the power of service towards central planning. Ambedkar and Nehru agreed that the social and economic modernization of India would have to be secured by vigorous planning actions emanating from Nehru. Conservative politicians sitting in the state would be disciplined by wiser and more far-sighted means sitting in the country's capital. The first five-year plan focused heavily on the primary sector. The last person to be allotted outlay with greater agriculture, irrigation, energy, transport, and communication time. Community aid development services. The state will play an active role in all sectors of the economy. This was justified by the immediate problems facing the economy in terms of the deficiency of capital. The second five-year plan, that is 1956-61, adopted what would come to be known as the Mahanandis model, after the renowned Indian statistician, the Santa Claus Mahanandis. This model attempted to calculate the most efficient allotment of each of the productive sectors so as to maximize long-term growth. Economic data and techniques developed at the Indian Statistical Institute were used. So, at the time, the total heavily on industrial development and rapid industrialization with investment into basic and heavy industries in the public sector. Hydroelectric and steel plants were started. Coal production was increased and railway routes were expanded. The Great Fire Plan attempted at balancing the neglect that agriculture had suffered for the previous term. There was an emphasis on improving agricultural production, however, was declining in 1962 in Pakistan in 1965 means that defense spending increased sharply, draining away from available resources. At the end second tier flight, the government illustrated the disaster in France, probably subsequently, and increased in defense, spending, reserve, lack of resources, replacement, and reserve, lack of appeals to 1966, 67, 67, 68, and 68, 69, being guided by enemy planes. The immediate action, the immediate attention was paid to improving agriculture growth in 1966 in order to stimulate exports by reaping growth data. The second thing, India was the agreement Prime Minister State of India in 1966. The first step is returned to earlier surplus growth of the government in India has been dominated. 13 major Indian banks were nationalized and the proposal was made to abolish from the buses from terminal dealers of the country streets. A proposal that had been removed from the Asian Bank at the first plan was survived by the Ministry. Anti-poverty programs that meant to create a mass independent force among the middle class working class. Gandhi succeeded in accumulating political power and pursued, especially through India's victory over Pakistan that resulted in the creation of Bangladesh in 1970. However, challenges arising from wartime spending and drought struggles with economic growth. One of the many policies taken by the Indian Gandhi government was the nationalization of 14 major Indian banks. This places all speculation in investment activity carried out by banks and a strict government regulation. The court also had the 42nd amendment was added to the Indian government, making 28 being a socialist government. In general, Westlake found the network of banks increased and increased to rural and poorer customers and thus integrate a larger portion of the population into the banking system, which would result in higher savings for the bank. Because even profit interest would not have allowed for an extension of the banking system into the remote areas of the country. However, the nationalization of banks was undertaken not only in the purpose of the economy, as India and it also sought to gain political knowledge to maintain this move to the very big attack movement. Determined to stay in the end to be part of universal development. The Indian is the promise that India was to have ever built now, compared to her partisan interests by new political enemies. On the basis of a threat to internal security, resulting from the recently concluded war against Pakistan in East and West, and economic downturn resulting from the April crisis of the 1970s, and the subsequent trade union activities started stalling the economy, in the Gandhi, Kennedy, then President of India, Hakobin, and even declared the state of national emergency on the 25th of June, 1975. It was the last couple of months. During this period, it not only restricted the partisan vision of Indira Gandhi, but also put forth another drama of development. Further, under the emergency, the Delhi Development Authority, DDA, took on a new, more authoritarian role as a dynamic nomad that seems to be not creating a more developed urban space. While these devices were suddenly relocated into a new developed family called Delta. This reflects an upward development of the colors, the lines, dressing, the bodies, capitalist countries, where a strong adoption presence of color at the reviews, and an unhappy client that must be fixed by a delivering state. This aggressive policy of sterilization reflects the behavior of the approach to development that the Indira Gandhi government implemented. The various measures taken by the Prime Minister, the Indian economic experience of relatively stagnant growth rate at an average of 3.5% from the 1950s to 1980s, while per capita income the initial reasons given for this retarded growth rate were attributed to cultural and social aspects of Indian life, chiefly that secularism and contentment of Indian life is resulted in the growth rate being called the Indian rate of growth. However, later economists have argued that the developmental path undertaken by the subsequent government of independent India was itself responsible for this growth rate, even an extraordinary and cultural factor. One of the prime examples of excessive government regulation, which is believed to have contributed to the slow growth rate, was that we now know as the licensed government. This refers to excessive and strictly growth proposal given the bureaucracy that limited the ability of businesses to sell. Any application for a private enterprise has to go through at least 80 government agencies and departments before being given the license to produce. And subsequent extension of the enterprise was to be heavily regulated by the government by the means of various labor laws and, in particular, the Monetary and Restrictive Trade Practices Act, maybe signed. Despite the strenuous posturing of the Indian government, there was a significant suppression of labor rights and trade related activities in the 1970s and 1980s, as seen in Bombay, Delhi, and West Bengal. This indicates a certain affinity to the interest of big capital, as have also been laid down in the body plans in 1944, where the eight major industrialists of India had proposed massive public expenditure in order to create an infrastructure conducive to businesses. In the 1980s, the government of Indira Gandhi and Rajiv Gandhi began to take economic policy even more clearly towards the interests of businesses. They began to relax the restrictions placed upon industry by the regulation of the government. Progress in 2009 talks only when he says that a major effect of these policies was to shift the balance of capital formation in India through the 1980s. After a period of rapid growth in the 1970s, the public sector capital formation stabilized and the private sector began to contribute more to capital formation. But we can see that during the economic reforms of 1991, where the government accepted a structural adjustment reforms in order to open up the economy to more foreign investments, was triggered by the crisis in the balance of trade. The 1980s can be seen as a precursor where the state had already begun to withdraw from its role as the main provider of social security. This withdrawal of the state was not in order to allow more dynamic to versatile social movements to spring up and exert pressure from below. but rather to allow more leaders or businesses and to action to conduct businesses without the restrictions of some labor laws and tariffs. Thank you.